Okay, so just to begin with, I'll introduce myself. I hope my voice is audible. If there is any problem with the voice, please give me your suggestion in the comment. So my name is Dr. Sunil Parab. I have been working for past 3 years as assistant professor in Dehradun. And now, as we can see, the conditions are changing around us due to COVID-19. The way the as it is being introduced by the government, now we have to find the new normal. What was normal, and now what is going to be a new normal? How we travel, how we do all the things in our day-to-day lives, we need to explore it again. We have to rethink about it again. And so I feel it is also necessary to think about our academics, about our clinical practice, about all the things we do in daily life. Along with that, there was one interesting motto given by our respected PM a few days ago when he said it is necessary to go local and be vocal about it. So I think it is a necessary timing when we communicate with our students regarding what is the local potential, what are the things we need to consider in future. Along with that, there is also lockdown in many places, and many of the students ask me again and again what they can do during this lockdown process, how they can utilize this time for the betterment. So we are going to talk about all those things today, and I see people joining in. So we'll just, I think, should we wait? So this is the first time I'm using this technology. I'm using Facebook Live for the first time. So please bear with me if there are any technical issues. So this is what I was talking about. So as per the things around us are changing, we need to update ourselves. We need to learn the new technology. And slow by slow, we'll get there. Yes. When we are talking about going local and being vocal about it, there is also a question. There is a thing that comes in my mind is about the potential that Uttarakhand has in field of Ayurveda. You know, many a times I wonder, like I have been in Uttarakhand for past 3 years because of course, I mean, many of the people within the audience right now are either in Uttarakhand because this is their birthplace, or, you know, as we say, it is a Janmabhoomi or Karma Bhoomi or Vidya Bhoomi. There are many people who are in Uttarakhand to study Ayurveda. So why we are in Uttarakhand? Basically, we are in Uttarakhand because we love that place. We love being in Uttarakhand within its natural beauty. And we also love the people over there. Yeah, Uttarakhand or Pahadi people are the nicest people you can ever meet. And that's why it makes Uttarakhand a perfect place where you would like to stay, you would like to study, or you would like to have your own startup. So why? But you know, all these things are very ideal in Uttarakhand. As we study in Samhita, we also know that the herbs found in Himalayan region are ideal. Then why, you know, it comes in my mind why Ayurveda in Uttarakhand has not made it its own mark as it has created in other regions. Like if we see in Kerala, the Kerala Ayurveda is identified with its own qualities. Yeah, Kerala is a tourist place, of course, but so is Uttarakhand. But we don't see that kind of branding or that kind of acceptance of Ayurveda in Uttarakhand. If we see Ayurveda in Maharashtra, if we see the clinical perspectives of Ayurveda in Gujarat, for that matter, we need to work very hard if we want to achieve those goals in Uttarakhand. The prime institutes like BHU, NIA, Jamnagar have introduced us quality standards. We need to think over it if we can also implement those clinical or those academic parameters in Uttarakhand. We have to strive very hard for the same. So we are going to think about we are going to discuss about many such points today. How we can contribute in upliftment of Ayurveda in Uttarakhand. As my students have asked what they can do during this lockdown period, what they can do in their homes, how we can go local and be vocal about Ayurveda in Uttarakhand. So these things we are going to discuss, and there are some of the online things available which we can utilize during this time. So yes, welcome. If there are any comments, you can put in your comments. If there are any questions also, you can put in your questions. So I'll try to simultaneously read those and get back to you. So starting. So I would like to first highlight the academic perspective of Ayurveda in Uttarakhand. So these are the list of colleges that are currently affiliated with Uttarakhand University. We have our own university in Uttarakhand, that is at Harawala. This is the Uttarakhand Ayurveda, the website. And almost 13-14 colleges that we have. So it shows a huge scope for academics that is available in Ayurveda. Many of these colleges have started functions in year 2017. So we are in currently in growing stage. We are establishing new colleges. There are some new colleges expected to open up in next 3 years. So this is one of the developing fields within Ayurveda. Of course, there's a huge scope. People can join in as practitioners, as clinicians, or as academicians, as researchers in these institutes. And there are two perspectives we have to think about while talking about academics. Rather, not just academics, but even as we talk about clinical practice or any perspective of Ayurveda, that whatever we have right now, how we can improve quality parameters in it. Yeah, many a times we don't even know if there are any quality parameters existing. So we need to find and establish clinical parameters, and we have to increase that quality parameters. Let it be about academics. So there is lot of things we can learn from institutes like NIA, Jamnagar, BHU, and we need to focus on how we can implement those parameters, how we can improve those parameters within our academics in Ayurveda academics in Uttarakhand. And of course, there will always be a scope for launching the new institutes, new research centers, and so on. This particular YouTube video, I would like to endorse. Yeah, I don't think there should be any problem if I say I would like to endorse this YouTube channel. This is by one of my teachers, Dr. Sumit Kesarkar. Dr. Sumit Kesarkar has done his PG in Dravyagun. He is an excellent academician and researcher, and he has explored the extreme villages in Uttarakhand for the herbs available in them. So I'll just show you some part of it. This is, I recommend this channel for all my students, because when you will see these videos, you will realize the things that are available within your villages. Yeah, many a times it happens that there are a lot of herbs present within your villages, but you don't know their significance. There are identifications in Sanskrit as well as Prakrut. Maybe you know the names, you identify the herbs with their local names, but you don't know their significance in Ayurveda. You don't know their Sanskrit names. Those then such kind of videos will help you understand their significance in Ayurveda. So I'll just show you this video.
So this is the Kakushandi peak. They say there is a vulture-like structure. I cannot make it out, but if I can make it out from the local, I'll just draw a line to show you how exactly it is a vulture perched on the top. I can see an inverted dome structure around there. Go to the left of it, there is Frank Smith Glacier or Valley of Flowers. Valley of Flowers is 6-7 district in Indian Paragraph. You will be exposed to a lot of untouched flora and
कट मेरा नाम श्रीमती रुक्मिणी देवी मारतोलिया, मैं अगर
so as we have seen in that particular video, the scholar, the academician or the researcher Dr. Sumit Kesarkar has communicated with the local people about the herbs which are traditionally used in that region, and those herbs are identified both in Prakrit language, what is your regional language, if it is Garhwali or Kumaoni. Rajivji, I hope, I think I need to understand how to share the YouTube video, and I hope my audio is clear now. I guess that must be about audio of YouTube. So I guess, yeah, this is new technology. I need to upgrade myself how to use it. So those videos I recommend all the students to watch. So you will understand it more better than me, because many of the words are in Garhwali or Kumaoni, so you can identify those words. You can check in your surroundings the availability of the herbs, and you can start working on that. See, basically, the practitioners, yeah, we have studied about Chikitsa Chatushpad, and one of the Chikitsa Chatushpad is Aushad. We need medicines. And those medicines are dependent on the herbal cultivation. So basically, herbal cultivation, if we have good cultivation, then we'll have good formulations. And if we have good formulations, then we'll have good results. And that will lead to good clinical practice. Yeah. So to be a good practitioner, it is also necessary to have availability of good herbs. So it is a great opportunity for students in Uttarakhand if you can identify herbs that can be cultivated within your region, if you can focus on how to collect it, how to transport it. There is a huge demand not only in our country but even in international market. So I think that is something you can study during this lockdown. Most of us are in our native places, so you can go around, talk with the local people. So this is one of the another website I wanted to show you. This is of State Medicinal Plants Board Uttarakhand. On this website, I want you to check the schemes, the projects and schemes mentioned over here. यहाँ पे जो projects और schemes बताए गए हैं, मैं चाहता हूँ कि हर student ये schemes check करे. आपको पता चलेगा कि government आपको herbal cultivation के लिए या collection के लिए या distribution के लिए क्या schemes provide कर रहा है. इसी के साथ heavily traded medicinal plants of Uttarakhand, ये list मैंने already open करके रखी थी. तो ये herbs already identify किए गए हैं government से जो huge demand में है. So this is a ready reckoner, ready reference for you. In herbs की huge demand है local, नेशनल एज वेल एज इंटरनेशनल मार्केट्स में. तो इसके ऊपर हमारा एक रिसर्च स्टडी हुआ था जो हमने फॉरेस्ट रिसर्च इंस्टीट्यूट में प्रेजेंट किया था. हमारे स्टूडेंट मृदुलिका ने प्रेजेंट किया था. तो इन दैट स्टडी वी हैड डिस्कस्ड व्हाट आर द ऑब्स्टेकल्स फॉर हर्बल कल्टिवेशन इन हिली रूरल पार्ट्स ऑफ उत्तराखंड एंड हाउ वी कैन ओवरकम दैट, what are the solutions for that. So one of the obstacle found was that the difference in identifying Sanskrit and Prakrit herbs with their terminologies. The second was identifying the local as well as national and international markets. So many a times the rural hilly people or the farmers don't know where to sell those herbs, how to collect those herbs, how to preserve those herbs. So this is a place, if you are not cultivating yourself, this is a place where you can provide a lot of help. If you can educate the farmers how to preserve, how to collect the herbs, there are separate guidelines as per Ayurveda how we are supposed to collect each herb. If you can understand that, if you can help your local farmers for that, I think that would be a great perspective, career perspective, along with your clinical practice. Okay, there is a National Medicinal Plants Board. And in National Medicinal Plants Board, you will see Medicinal Plants Database. There is Medicinal Plants Database. Here, not only Ayurveda, but you can access the database of herbs associated in homeopathy, Siddha, folk, Yunani, and Sowa Rigpa. Now, the interesting part I like in this is the distribution map. So they have given each herb over here, and we have to just click and see the map where it is available or which region is ideal for its cultivation. So you can check if that herb is can be cultivated in your region. Yes, so if we are talking about Uttarakhand, so yes, this herb is available. Now you can go ahead and you can search the details. So this is also another a way of searching herbs because we know which herbs are in demand, but at the same time, we can also look for the herbs which are rare, which are currently not in demand. But if you start cultivating that, those herbs, then it will make you it will be your USP, unique selling point. So I think we can think about that. We can go as per the Latin names mentioned over here, and accordingly, you can search if these herbs can be cultivated in your region or not. Now, next is the Sahita. When I'm taking my regular classes, I use this Charak Sahita. This is available online. This is available online, and this is a ready-made ready-made source of literary research at your home. So if you have internet connection, you can access all these Sahitas online. How to read this Sahita, I had taught many of my students. You have to select Sthan, chapter, and which shlok you want to study. Also, a Tika is mentioned over here. This is the website you have to visit, National Institute of Indian Medical Heritage. On this website, you have these Sahitas available or e-books, Charak Sahita, as we have seen, Shushrut Sahita, Madhav Nidan, e-Nigantu, and Ayu Handbook. So these Sahitas you can access online from your homes. On this website itself, there is an option of Namaste portal. If you open this, you will see this page, Namaste portal. And here they have given standardized Ayurvedic terminologies. So this is the home page, and you have to click on Ayurveda terminologies. You will go to the Ayurveda terminologies. So etymological approach. Yes, when we study Sahita, our focus is on etymology, understanding each word, how that word has originated, and all those words. I think this is still getting updated, but most of the words you can find over here, and this is a great source again for literary research. So many people feel that research is a huge thing. Research is a very huge thing to be executed. How to do it and who can guide us. I would like to tell you that in past 3 years, we have trained and we have promoted our students for research in let it be literary research, let it be meta-analysis, let it be observational studies. Yeah, because clinical research, you need many things for that. You need a lot of approvals for that. But we decided we wanted to do something challenging, and we decided that why don't we promote our first year and second year BMS students for research studies. That's what we did. And I'm proud to say that most of my students have presented their research studies in prime institutes like AIIMS Rishikesh, BHU. Many of them also had traveled to Gujarat to attend a conference and communicate with many international scholars present over there. So if you want to see what kind of research studies we had done, you can visit our college website. And here on the research, you will see the list of research presentations that we had done. So you can go through the details. The point I want to make over here is that if first year, second year students can do research studies based on literary research, meta-analysis or observational studies, I think most of us, most of the PG students, most of the practitioners can also take an initiative. If you need any kind of guidance, if you need any kind of support, you are always welcome to connect with us. You can always contact us. We are making a panel of academicians who are ready to volunteer and support as per their expertise, irrespective of which institute you are associated with. There will be clinicians who will help the students for understanding, identifying herbs or their cultivations. There will be clinicians, academicians who will help and guide the students for research. There will be people who would like to promote Agni Karma or Kshar Sutra. And so it will be irrespective of any particular academic institute, but it will be for the benefit of students or the practitioners within Uttarakhand. So we are focusing on that, and in coming days, many clinicians or practitioners or researchers are going to use this platform to communicate with you. I hope you will join us for the regular sessions to understand what is the existing condition in Uttarakhand, what is right now present scenario, how we can improve it in terms of quality standards, quality parameters, and third, how we can introduce new things. So there will be these different perspectives, and all the people who are working on the ground level in Uttarakhand are going to share their actual experiences. So PubMed, many of my students are working on that for their meta-analysis research studies. This is one more interesting area which I want to highlight in this session. It is of National Mission for Manuscripts. If you know, most of the manuscripts found in the Indian continent are available in regions like Nepal or Bhutan. Because of their weather, because it is a cold weather, there are chances that manuscripts can be preserved, can remain preserved for a longer duration. I feel the similar weather conditions are there in Uttarakhand. So there is a probability that there would be many manuscripts still available in the hilly regions of Uttarakhand. And this is a place where an Ayurveda practitioner or researcher can hugely contribute. Any handwritten document which is 75 years or older than that is being considered as manuscript. And there is National Mission for Manuscripts, which supports and encourages preservation of such manuscripts. So if you have any manuscripts in your region, if you know people who have such kind of documents, you can directly get in touch with NAMAMI, that is National Mission of Manuscripts, for the preservation of the same. As you know, we are studying most of our knowledge is from Sanhita. So those Sanhitas were procured, that text was procured from such manuscripts. And there is a possibility that many such manuscripts might be still available, still not studied, still not incorporated in our syllabus. So if you find such manuscripts, it gives us a scope of transliteration and translation. So that is again a type of a research. Transliteration is when we change the lipi, the script. Okay, so if there is a script called as Grantha, Kharoshti, then to convert it into Devanagari, that is transliteration. And then if it is Sanskrit, to translate it into Hindi, that is translation. The language, the difference in script would be transliteration, and difference in language would be translation. So that is also one of the scope of research in Ayurveda, that is manuscriptology. We need to spread awareness for finding, searching such manuscripts, preserving them, or doing digitization of the same to promote the research. So that is one of the scope where you can do, like, along with the herbs, you can also look for the manuscripts in your villages. You can focus on them. In your villages, there is one more research perspective available, that is epidemiology. So I would not suggest you to do epidemiology studies right now at this time of pandemic when we are under lockdown and people might be hesitant to share their details with you if, you know, their health details at this scenario. But when we are out of this pandemic situation, so I would suggest you to take epidemiological research studies in your region. That will help you understand your local region in a better way. That will help you understand the population in your region, the demands, the problems being, the health problems being faced by them, the deficiencies of a healthcare system available. And apart from research study, it will also help you have a focused approach in your clinical practice. Apart from that, of course, there's a huge demand for Ayurveda practitioners in public healthcare services. You can enter as a consultant, or you can enter as administrators as well. So that is also one of the areas where you can focus. I have seen many Ayurveda practitioners who are working as medical officers in public healthcare, and they're integrating allopathy as well as Ayurveda. And that is a fantastic thing to see over there. Since you have best herbs available at local market in the hilly regions, if you know how to utilize them, that can also reduce the cost burden, the healthcare cost burden on the patients. So, you know, I'm just rushing through many points. Each point or each area would require a separate session to talk about, but I wanted to give you a nutshell of the various possibilities that are awaiting you after COVID-19, during this lockdown, and so on. Okay, so we talked about academics, we talked about herbal cultivation, we talked about research to some length. Apart from that, I would like to talk about clinical practice. Yes, there are specializations. If you just go out and explore in other regions of India, you will find specializations of Ayurveda practice. For example, now, Panchakarma is becoming more and more popular in Uttarakhand. So Panchakarma is one of the specializations. Then there is Agnikarma, there is Shar Sutra. Marma Chikitsa is very popular in Uttarakhand. Joshi sir, Naveen Joshi sir, and Sunil Joshi sir, both are very respected and popular practitioners and academicians in Uttarakhand, and they have been promoting Marma Chikitsa and training for the same. So those are some of the upgradations that we can have in our practice. Rasa Aushadhi, Padmashri Dr. Balendu Prakash sir, there is a lot to learn about not just manufacturing, but about practicing Rasa Aushadhi from sir. Along with these branches of Ayurveda, there are different other things which you can collaborate along with Ayurveda. So if you go in Kerala, you will see how Siddha is being practiced hand in hand with Ayurveda. So that can be one of the perspectives you can look for. There are many other options as well, such as many people like to use yoga along with Ayurveda, physiotherapy along with Ayurveda, aromatherapy, color therapy. So there are numerous things which I had also discussed in my classes. Within Ayurveda also, there are different perspectives of diagnosing and treating the ailments. For example, I had given the reference of Pancha Bhautik Chikitsa. So Pancha Bhautik Chikitsa is very, very interesting thing. Everyone must learn and try to integrate in your own practice. As far as diagnostics is concerned, Nadi Pariksha, Jivha Pariksha play a vital role. I just saw Dr. Smita Naram ma'am joining us in this session, and she is my teacher, she is my mentor for learning Nadi Pariksha. She taught me how to do Nadi Pariksha. So that is those are some of the fantastic tools that we need to learn, we need to bring in the region of Uttarakhand. We need to share such kind of knowledge, and we need to upgrade the status of Ayurveda in terms of academics, in terms of research, in terms of cultivation, in terms of formulations, in terms of clinical practice. So if we talk about formulations, there are many pharmacies, there are many famous pharmacies in Uttarakhand, but you need to check which medicines are highly being prescribed or highly being ordered in your hospitals or clinical practices, and you will see many of those medicines are being imported from Maharashtra, Karnataka and Gujarat. So it's okay, you know, taking those medicines from other regions, but then it puts a question that if it is being mentioned that the best medicines are available in Himalayan region, then why are we taking medicines from other regions? Of course, it can be individual choice. It can be about authenticity of formulations. It can be about better applicability, better availability. But the question then we have to ask is, can we introduce the same in our region? So that again opens up a huge scope for the current students. If you can focus on very authentic preparations, authentic collection of herbs. So there is a huge, huge opportunity available out there. And as I said, we are creating a panel of experts who would guide all the, any students who are willing to come ahead, learn these skills. There is a huge potential in Uttarakhand as a region, as the availability of experts, availability of sincere students, availability of the institutes which want to bring a change in society. So there are many things available, just we need to coordinate and we have to focus on making most of it. Let's see if there are any questions. I will take any questions if there are. Okay, so currently I don't see any questions, and thank you for joining in this session. On Tuesday, we are going to communicate with Dr. Ankit Agrawal, who is a consultant and director of Tulsi Ayurveda in Dehradun. Ankit has done his UG Ayurveda studies in Uttarakhand. He is currently pursuing his PG studies, and He is a private practitioner as well as a researcher. We are going to communicate with him to understand about his experience and his perspective about Ayurveda academics, Ayurveda practice, and Ayurveda research in Uttarakhand or in Dehradun. What are the things as a student, as a practitioner, as an academician, he appreciates? What are the things he finds to be lacking in our region? And, you know, once we have that kind of feedback, what is lacking, then we can think about solutions, how we can bring the change, how we can contribute at our level. So please join us for our next talk on Tuesday with Dr. Ankit Agrawal. Till then, see ya. Thank you.